1 for local news in Ottawa and the Valley. This is City News, now on 101.1 FM and 1310 AM.
It's Thursday, November 11th. Good morning. I'm Andrew Boyle. Right now in Ottawa, zero. In Smiths Falls, minus 2 degrees. Here's what's making news in Ottawa and the Valley. Crowds of people once again allowed to gather at the National War Memorial honoring fallen soldiers at the largest Remembrance Day ceremony in Canada. It comes as we mark an important milestone for an iconic symbol of Remembrance Day. Here's City News Parliament Hill reporter Cormac McSweeney.
The 100th anniversary of the poppy as the symbol of remembrance in Canada.
Najma Bond with the Canadian Legion says a century ago, French native Anna Garand brought to Canada the idea of wearing a poppy to help raise funds for struggling veterans, inspired by the poem in Flanders Fields. The national ceremony will once again be a scaled-back event due to COVID, with fewer officials taking part in no veterans parade. But with restrictions easing, people will once again be allowed to line the streets and watch in person. However, it's not clear how many will show up. Typically, the event draws around 30,000. Whether people are at the ceremony, at home, or at work, Bond says we should pause and remember.
These veterans have sacrificed so much for us, including their lives, so that we can be here today.
The Prime Minister and Governor General are just some of the dignitaries taking part in the ceremony. Cormac McSweeney, Parliament Hill.
City News Time, 9:01, and now your forecast with meteorologist Jill Taylor.
Above average temperatures as we mark Remembrance Day, but with that gusty wind out of the east, it will feel cooler than the temperature indicates. The high today, 9 degrees. We'll get into the rain overnight, 5 for the low, and tomorrow we'll start with rain, some showers for the afternoon, and continuing windy, a high about 12 degrees. For today, the high, 9.
And right now it's 0 in Ottawa, minus 2 degrees in Smiths Falls. Now keep in mind, if you do have some shopping to do, most of these stores are closed until 12:30 this afternoon. Exceptions, places like pharmacies and corner stores and gas stations. Most of the city and provincial offices are also closed today, as are federal offices. Garbage and recycling, though, is still being collected today. Also keep in mind that at 11 o'clock, buses in Ottawa and Gatineau will pull over for 2 minutes of silence if it is safe to do so. Now, there is a full list of what's open and closed this morning at ottawa.citynews.ca. City News Time, 9:02. Fire that began on the roof of a garage at a Rideau Valley Drive home spread to that house. Firefighters received the initial call for help around 2:30 this morning. Now, crews arrived. They confirmed fire covered the roof of the attached garage and was quickly spreading to the home. No injuries were reported, but an excavator had to be called in to help remove debris to find any hot spots. Damage to the home, roughly $750,000. Fire investigator has been called in to determine the cause. The province is pausing its plan to lift capacity limits in remaining settings where proof of vaccination is required, following a rise in COVID-19 cases recently. The province had planned on removing a cap on the number of people permitted in nightclubs, strip clubs, sex clubs, and bathhouses next Monday. Dr. Kieran Moore, Ontario's top doctor, says that move is delayed now for at least 28 days as he monitors the COVID-19 caseload. The decision comes a day after the health minister in the province, Christine Elliott, says Ontario would stay the course in its reopening plan. The province says hospital and intensive care capacity remains stable, but the positivity rate is increasing. Ontario did have 454 new cases of COVID-19 yesterday. And the United Nations Secretary General says climate talks in Glasgow are at a crucial moment and need to accomplish more than securing a weak deal that nations agree to support. Talks are due to wrap up tomorrow, and they are offering a grim assessment at the UN that the goal of limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius is on life support. I'm Andrew Boyle for News Anytime. Follow up online at ottawa.citynews.ca.
Inform your opinion.
It's the Rob Snow Show on Rogers TV and City News.
101.1 FM and 1310 AM.
Jack Rose was a telegraph operator from Vancouver. He was with the 10th Fortress Signal Company in 1942 and was taken prisoner during the Battle of Hong Kong. His mother's name was Jean.
My darling son, Jack, so far we have received no letter from you. I do hope that you are receiving our letters. Darling, I hope you are well and in good spirits. I pray for you every night, my darling. You are never out of my thoughts. I sometimes feel that I can't go on anymore, but I am going to carry on and have only one thought in mind. To see you again. Darling, how I will take care of you when you come home. For my sake, keep your chin up. Say your prayers every night, darling. I am going through it with you. Everyone keeps asking about you. May God bless you and take care of you. I am sure He will hear my prayers. Darling, I love you so much that it hurts. Mother.
Christmas Day, 1942. And all Ed Bernanski can think about is home and the wife he left behind. Originally a welder from Saskatchewan, Bernanski would be spending this Christmas in England as a mechanic in the Royal Canadian Air Force.
Boys are home again, all over the world.
December 25th, 1942. My dearest wife, Yelenka. Sweetheart, you can't realize, even if you understand, what a Christmas day I've had. I don't feel no self-pity, and I'm not asking for sympathy, but I can't sit here by myself and even make myself believe that it was Christmas Day today.
When the lights go on again, all over the world.
There are four boys sleeping in this hut with me, and it seems they all live nearby as they left last night to spend Christmas at home. This morning I woke up in a cold and miserable hut to find myself alone.
Time for things like wedding rings.
There isn't much else to say. I went and had a wash and shave, and then sat around until it was time for dinner. I'm enclosing the menu, so there's no use in describing what we had. The officers served us. But you can't make a man happy by giving him a good meal. This afternoon, I sat around, read a couple of storybooks, then I went over and had tea. Cookies, cake, and tea. Sat around some more until 7, when I went down to the mess hall where they were holding a dance. I watched a couple of dances and came back.
Wherever you are you
Now here I am sitting in silence that is almost eerie, broken occasionally by some outburst of song as the guys pass down the road to the dance after being to the pub. I hope no one envies me in my solitude. Next Christmas morning when we wake up, please remind me of this one, darling, so I can look back upon it without any resentment and to enjoy that day even more so, to appreciate its fullness with you by my side. Okay, hon? Good night, sweetheart, and may God keep and bless you. And please, darling, don't be like me, but keep smiling, eh? Forever yours, with all my love, Hubby Ed.
Again, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.
Good morning. Welcome to the Rob Snow Show on City News.
Just like you.
There have been times over these last 18 months or so when I've wondered if this is what it was like during the war. Sacrifice, going without, mobilization, bravery, loss, hope. Hope that someday it will end and there will be victory. And then I read the letters. The letters from Canadians from the front lines of war. Letters sent home to family and friends, and I realize that while these pandemic times evoke many of the same emotions, what most of us have been asked to sacrifice, I'm not sure if anything could compare. I keep this book on my bookshelf at home. I always pull it out this time of year. It has become an annual ritual for me, the Book of War Letters. A lovely, timeless collection of letters from the front from so many brave Canadians, men and women, so skillfully gathered and presented by Audrey and Paul Gresko. And it's one of those letters that inspired my Snow in 60 commentary this morning on City News and Shea 106, the story of Mike Mountain Horse. So often as I read through this private, intimate correspondence from these young men and women so far away from home, Christmas is a common theme. There is so much misery with war and carnage and death and fear. But if there is a respite from all of that in this correspondent, it is when they talk about Christmas, about getting a parcel from home. For example, and this is some of what I will present to you this morning as part of our show, some letters from the front pulled from this book, read aloud by some of my broadcasting friends over the years. A letter like this one from Sergeant Leonard Chase of Nova Scotia, 1917, and he's a quartermaster with the 5th Canadian Battalion in France at the time. And he had an ongoing correspondence with a chaplain of the New York Fire Department, a lifelong friendship struck up after the two sat next to each other on a train trip. And it's Christmas of 1917. And a wooden box arrives for Sergeant Leonard in France from his American friend. And this is what he wrote. My dear friend, the luckiest man in France is about to fail miserably at writing a letter of thanks for a couple of boxes that arrived today. One by parcel post, another by ration train. Oh, such Christmas boxes. My thoughts are running riot tonight. I am just a big bunch of excitement and joy. I want to reach out and shake hands with you or call you on the phone and have a good long talk. Never. Since I was a wee kitty getting up early on Christmas morning to see what was under the tree, have I been so excited at Christmas time. I wouldn't have traded places with the king. You have given me the best coat in France. It fits perfectly. It's too good for this life. here I am, a quartermaster. I have a better coat than the majority of the staff officers out here. Know that there are a bunch of boys, not 1,000 miles behind the line, who have called you the Prince of Good Fellows. Your friend, Len. These nearly 2 years have tested everyone. We have missed out on things. We have missed family, missed friends, lost both. And as I read some of these letters again this week, I was thinking maybe these pandemic times will have given many of us a new sense of what real sacrifice is, of what real loss is, and most of all, what real appreciation means. I am also thinking about Rabbi Bulka this morning and his recent passing and how he was a fixture of Remembrance Day. We love our troops, he would say. We love our troops, and they loved him. Coming up on our program, we'll take your calls of remembrance, of thanks, during the talk back hour. I'll speak with councillor Matt Luloff, war veteran, Stephen Dieter, deputy commander of the Royal Canadian Legion. He will lay a wreath today at the National War Memorial alongside the Prime Minister of Canada. And Dr. Tim Cook, the wonderful historian from the Canadian War Museum, on remembrance through the decades, how Remembrance Day was almost lost, and how it is our obligation to remember. This is the Rob Snow Show on City News.
It was devastating, and it's devastating to all small business, but not knowing where it was going to go. But then the renovation market, as people stayed home, took off like wildfire. And for us, yes, we're very lucky, very fortunate that we were able to turn things around. I think a lot of it had to do with our internet presence as well, that I was, you know, kept working on over years, and then it kind of took off. So that was very positive. But now, no, people are staying at home. We're renovating different markets, whether it's a kitchen or a backyard or, you know, your fireplace. They want to cozy things up. So yes, things are extremely busy right now. Right now it's fireplaces, and I think with the snowbirds, a lot of those clients have existing wood fireplaces, so they're looking at inserts. So they want to convert the wood to gas. They don't want to deal with the wood part of it, but they want it clean and easy and efficient, and that's been a major, major increase in our business. The cottage and chalet market has really increased, absolutely. We see that people, that's their staycation now, is either the backyard or their cottage with their close bubble of family. So there's no question that we've seen a big, big increase in that area as well. I've seen a change in the backyard because now the staycation, you know, being in the pool business, one of our great clients was in the other day, and he's in the pool business. He's booking for 2022 for in-ground pools, okay? So I think what's happened now is that's brought everybody back home. And I think maybe down the road, maybe 3, 4, 5 years from now, we're still gonna see people spending time in their backyards and staying home more. The barbecue area, really, we call it the backyard. So you walk out of your house into a backyard, and it kind of looks like that with the fencing and the sky and things like that. So that is just our fun room. It's just, there's a lot of cool gadgets there that has to do with dealing with charcoal and wood pellet barbecues. To go online, you're going to find, you just Google, you know, romantic fireplaces will come up. The one nice thing about our work is that when you, the Google reviews and the Google pictures are phenomenal. We're uploading stuff every day. I have at least 1,000 jobs, real jobs that you can take a look at, either on the Google pictures on the drive, or if you go to our website at romanticfireplaces.com and click on our work. It's where we used to load lots of them up, but there's lots of pictures there too. But the great thing about that is they're real. There's testimonials there about people talking about our team. And our team here is unique to everybody else. It's two small teams, but these fellas work for me. They're our guys. So when they go into your home, they care as much about your house as you do.
He's the opinionated Ottawa icon.
The Rob Snow Show returns
on Rogers TV and City News.
101.1 FM and 1310 AM.
And honored to welcome to our program this morning, Stephen Dieter, Deputy Commander, Royal Canadian Legion. Good morning.
Good morning, Rob.
Very nice to hear from you. I'm so thankful that you could take the time to talk to us and our listeners this morning. This is the 100th year of the poppy as a symbol of remembrance. What does the poppy mean to you?
Oh, the poppy has an absolute wonderful symbol of remembrance. Of course, being the symbol that many children learn in school as part of John McCrae's iconic poem In Flanders Fields. It was the symbol that was adopted by a couple of women, Moira Michael and Anna Guerin, in the years immediately after the First World War, which was promoted by the American, with the American veterans, the British veterans, the Canadian veterans, the French veterans, to raise funds for widows and orphans of those who died during the First World War. And it's that symbol that we have continued to cherish now here in Canada for the past 100 years, and it's something which the Royal Canadian Legion uses and continues to symbolize as that fundraising element for what we use to I'll say solicit funds, but that's not really the right word, because what we do is we ask for funds from the public to help the veterans.
Yes.
Who have survived combat, who have survived peacekeeping missions, who have survived their time in uniform, who need assistance.
Our Legion branches, in speaking with people from the Legion this time last year, there was some doubt about even the viability of some Legion branches across the country. Because of COVID, because of restrictions, because of being unable to have events and whatnot. How are our Legion branches doing across the country?
You know, Rob, this time last year, and I said this to a number of your colleagues in the media, we've got a very resilient bunch of people in the Royal Canadian Legion, and we still do. We've had a couple of branches that have had trouble, and that has been a case of small branches that had small numbers of people.
Yes.
And that happens. I mean, that's just a simple case of location. If you have small numbers, you're going to face a case of attrition. It's just simple logistics. We were very fortunate with the government providing funds to Legion branches to help them survive. Some branches have amalgamated. Some branches have survived, but have had to restructure the way that they operate. Some have gone to reduced hours. Some have gone to the way that they offer services to the community in a slightly different format. But the key factor that they provide services to veterans has never changed, and that's been the key element that we as a community, and that's the thing, the Legion is open to all Canadians to join.
Yes.
That we collectively provide that service back to the veteran community. And when you look at who in our collective community throughout the your broadcast region have been members of the military, who are eligible or who are able to come into a Legion branch and ask for service assistance. That's a big community, and the fact that those Legion branches exist, and there's 62 of them in the region from Napanee north and east to the Quebec border, and then going across the Quebec border, there's a number as well. That's a huge area that that I look after as a public relations officer, and I have 10 here as the deputy commander in the Ottawa region, that we look after just to keep functioning, and we try to keep them going. And now that we're back to full capacity, we're able to have events, we're able to welcome people back in, as we will today after our services. We're trying to re-engage with the community so that we remind people we're still here, we're able to offer our services to veterans, we're able to be here as a community outlet, and we're welcoming people back in our doors.
You will be laying a wreath during the national ceremony today alongside the Prime Minister.
Yes, sir.
What a tremendous honor that must be for you.
It absolutely is. Yes. I've been very fortunate in my Legion time. This is my third opportunity to be part of the national ceremony. Several years ago, I was part of the veterans contingent as their commander. The first time was the year that we lost Corporal Nathan Cirillo and Warrant Officer Patrice Vincent. I led the veterans contingent on parade while I was still in military uniform, so that was quite the honor. So this year, when I was as a deputy commander here in the zone to be asked, well, appointed to escort the Prime Minister and his wife to lay their wreath this year is an equally great honor. So to have this moment is just... I can't describe it. It's just a fantastic chance.
I'm wondering, Deputy Commander, who or what will you be thinking about at that moment?
Every Remembrance Day, I think about my grandfather. He was a with the Armored Corps during the Second World War, and I think about him. Every Remembrance Day, I automatically think about my Grandpa Frank, and I always think about... him and his time with the Gray and Simcoe Foresters, which was an armored unit in the Second World War. That's always who I think about during this time. And I think back to when I was a kid, and I actually was on parade with him when I was 9 years old, and I laid a wreath as a Cub Scout. And that's exactly who I think about.
Well, you're going to have a nice day for it. +8 is not a bad Remembrance Day. A little windy, but it will be wonderful to have vets and crowds back at the ceremony. Agreed, Deputy Commander?
You know, Rob, 10 years ago, I was on deployment in Jamaica where it was 48 degrees with Humidex, so I will take 8 degrees with a little bit of wind. This is very nice.
Yes, it should be a wonderful day. A very thoughtful day. Solemn day,
absolutely.
Of course.
Very solemn, but when you, with all the services around the Ottawa region and up in the valley, plenty of opportunities for everyone to take the time to pause and remember, whether it be at 11 a.m. or be at some point throughout the day.
Deputy Commander Stephen Dieter, thank you for everything.
Thank you very much, Rob.
Yes. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Right after the news, Dr. Tim Cook, historian, Canadian War Museum. This is City News.
Thank you.
in Ottawa and the Valley. This is City News, now on 101.1 FM and 1310 AM.
It's Thursday, November 11th. Good morning. I'm Andrew Boyle. Right now in Ottawa, above freezing now at 2 degrees, Smith Falls 3. Here's what's making news this hour. People are gathering at the War Memorial at Elgin and Wellington in preparation for the Remembrance Day ceremony. That begins with a couple of minutes of silence at 11. Prime Minister and Governor General among those who will be laying wreaths today. While the ceremony has been scaled back this year, people are allowed at the War Memorial, so there are road closures in effect in that area. Stores also remain closed until 12:30 this afternoon. Also, city and federal offices are closed. $750,000 damage done to a home south of Cars early this morning. About 2:30, firefighters were called to Rideau Valley Drive South. Flames on the roof of the attached garage had spread to the house. An excavator had to be brought in so firefighters could find hot spots. Talks between the federal government and child welfare advocates on compensating First Nations children taken from their homes will be led by the former chairman of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Former Senator Murray Sinclair, highly respected voice on matters of reconciliation between Indigenous and non-Indigenous people. F.W. de Klerk, who shared the Nobel Peace Prize with Nelson Mandela, and as South Africa's last apartheid president, oversaw the end of the country's white minority rule, has died at the age of 85. The F.W. de Klerk Foundation confirmed today the former president died after a battle of cancer against cancer at his home. City News Time, 9:32. I'm Andrew Boyle. For news anytime, follow up online at ottawa.citynews.ca.
Strong voice.
Strong opinions.
Rob Snow Show returns on Rogers TV and City News.
101.1 FM and 1310 AM.
As the War Museum historian Dr. Tim Cook reminded us recently in an excellent column in the Globe and Mail, this year is the 100th anniversary of the poppy's adoption by Canadian veterans to mark, quote, war, loss, and the obligation of remembrance. And Tim Cook joins us this morning on City News. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, it's very nice to hear from you. I'm so happy that we could get you on the line. You wrote for the Globe that the war, the Great War, World War I, quote, continued to reverberate long after the guns fell silent, with profound effects all over the world. Mm-hmm. What are some examples?
Well, that war from 1914 to 1918 remade the world. Empires were destroyed, Austria-Hungary, Germany. We saw the rise of communism in Russia. The Middle East was remade. And if we think of Canada, a country of 8 million, more than 66,000 Canadians were killed, even as our fighting forces came together to help propel Canada forward to a new sense of nationhood. So just titanic, cataclysmic changes emerging from the war. And even though the guns fell silent, at least on the Western Front, on November 11th, 1918, it continued to reverberate through the 1920s, through the 1930s, and I would argue to today as well. There is a long, dark shadow of war that has affected multiple generations.
And I think about Vimy and really the birth of a nation at Vimy. Dr. Cook.
That's right. And you may remember I wrote a book on Vimy in 2017, which looked at Vimy as a really powerful martial symbol for many Canadians. This idea of Canada coming together to do something hard, English Canadians and French Canadians and new Canadians and Indigenous Canadians, Canadians from every region in the country, every city, every town, every village. And Vimy has become a powerful symbol, I think, from the war. But of course, there are other powerful symbols. If we think of remembrance and commemoration, and perhaps the obligation to bear witness, and things like Remembrance Day, which emerged from the war, John McCrae's poem in Flanders Fields, 2 minutes of silence, and of course, the poppy.
Yeah, just about every Canadian student learns in elementary school about John McCrae and his poem in Flanders Fields. I want to ask you, how did John McCrae die?
Yeah, The poem has outlived him, of course, and John McCrae, born in Guelph, Ontario, was a Canadian of his time, a gifted young man, had gone off to the war in South Africa, but then had come back and had studied and was a prolific and well-known physician in Montreal. And he went overseas in the First World War to save lives, a frontline surgeon. And he was there in the Battle of Second Ypres, where the Germans unleashed chlorine gas for the first time in the history of warfare in April of 1915. And he cared for Canadians and British soldiers and Indian soldiers. And he wrote his poem there. And the poem has lived on and became a really powerful symbol. But he died of disease in January of 1918. Also of overwork, and he suffered from what we would now call post-traumatic stress disorder. But his poem has lived on, and I think the genius of the poem is that if you look at the actual words, it is about the dead imploring the living to keep up the fight against the enemy. But in the 1920s, the poem's meaning changes, and Canadians looked at that poem, and it became a call to hold that torch of remembrance from the dead to the living, to remember the service and sacrifice.
And who was Madame Anna Guerra?
Madame Guerra, also known as the Poppy Lady, was a French woman who deeply affected by war, who believed it important to care for the wounded veterans and to continue the remembrance of the sacrifice. And she traveled much of the Western world talking about the importance of adopting the poppy. And of course, the poppy, deeply grounded in John McCrae's poem, had been accepted as a wartime symbol. And there were Canadians before Anna Guerin who came to Canada in 1921. There were Canadians who were saying, we need a poppy. The poppy will be a symbol to remember the fallen. But she met with Canadian veterans, the precursor to the Canadian Legion, and the Legion adopted the poppy in 1921 as a wearable symbol, as an icon, as an emblem of remembrance, that powerful red flower to be worn visibly as a sign of never forgetting.
Yeah, I have to admit, before reading your column, I had never heard of the Great War Veterans Association, the GWVA. What was that?
Well, veterans began to come back to Canada during the war. Those who were badly wounded, tens of thousands returned to Canada during the war, and they realized that they had an obligation to their comrades overseas, to those who were buried overseas and those who were still fighting. So veterans began to come together, and the Great War Veterans Association was one of literally dozens of veterans groups established in 1917 to really to fight for the rights of veterans in Canada. And they all came together, or many of these groups came together in 1925 to form what is now called the Royal Canadian Legion. But I think if we were to come back to your original question of legacies of war, if we think of the First World War, powerful legacies of Canada stepping out onto the world stage, of creating new national symbols, of nearly being torn apart through conscription, the legacy of income tax, the legacy of enfranchisement for women, another very powerful legacy, of course, is that of veterans. The creation of some 550,000 surviving veterans, and they would be a force in Canadian society, joined by their children of the Second World War, of which by the end of that terrible conflict, that necessary war against fascism, there were another million veterans. And of course, there have been hundreds of thousands of other Canadians who have served in wars and conflicts. And I think on this day, Remembrance Day, we think of them, we think of their service, we think of the loss, the grief. It is a day of pride, it is a day of reflection, it is a day grounded in history and yet so very relevant in the present.
We know so much more about PTSD now and its terrible effect on veterans. The veterans of the Great War or the Second World War or Korea, how are they treated, if at all, if they showed signs of what we now know as PTSD? I mean, were they pretty much on their own to deal with those issues? Or?
Well, war has always forced us to change and be transformed. And medicine went through massive transformations during the First World War and the Second World War. And it just written a book on that, which will be out next year, called Lifesavers and Body Snatchers. Just the incredible role of doctors, if we just look at the First World War, where half of all Canadian doctors served overseas, and there were incredible medical transformations in saving these bodies that came in mangled and burned and gassed, blood transfusions and the use of x-ray and surgical advances. But one of those wounds that they grappled with were mental wounds, and it was very difficult to treat, of course, and that the evolving treatment really unfolded over decades. And I think it would be fair to say that while the Army or was interested in treating soldiers who were suffering from shell shock in the First World War, battle stress as it was known in the Second World War, there wasn't a lot of treatment after the war when veterans came home and returned to their communities and to their loved ones. And they often struggled with these invisible injuries. And I think, as you have said, we have a greater sense of that today, and yet it still remains a very difficult wound to treat and to deal with, and one that we as a society continue to struggle with.
In the 60s, peace and love, anti-war movement, counterculture, what effect did that culture have on Remembrance Day in Canada?
Well, the short answer is it nearly destroyed it.
Really? Wow.
We nearly lost Remembrance Day in my book, The Fight for History, which looks at the evolution of the way that we think about the Second World War. I was shocked to find in my research that in the 60s and 70s that Remembrance Day almost disappeared, that Canadians were simply not interested in marking it. The Globe and Mail in 1968 described it as a day of indifference. A day of indifference. Wow. Canadians simply did not care. And the reasons are complex. It was a changing generation, a pushback against authority. The war in Vietnam was raging. And yet, I find that difficult to imagine, that Remembrance Day was in danger of being cast into oblivion. And yet, of course, a day like Remembrance Day is one that changes with Canadian society. We ascribe meaning to it year after year, generation after generation, and is not the same as we fight in more wars and more conflicts, as we engage in the eternal search for peace. We have more veterans and different types of veterans, and yet we as Canadians have also changed, and the things that we hold up to be dear change from generation to generation. And so while something like Remembrance Day or the poppy seems like it's always been with us, and it has for most of us who are under the age of 100 or so, nonetheless, it is a living day, and I think that adds something to the power of it, its ability to move us and to connect with us, grounded in the past, yet living in the present, and I hope there for us in the future.
How are we doing now, in your opinion? Remembrance Day 2021, it's been 18, 19 months of extraordinary sacrifice for so many people, and we've seen what the pandemic has done to the elderly, those who live through war. How are we doing in honoring our obligation of remembrance, Dr. Cook?
Well, if we go back to this idea that the day changes with us as society changes, of course, last year and this year, we have been plagued by COVID, and it has an impact on every aspect of our society, including aspects of remembrance and commemoration. I think if we take a step back and look at the day over the last 25 years, it has been strengthened. It has been marked by Canadians. It's not like in the 60s and 70s when it was in danger of dying out. New generations have made that pledge to say that this matters and that we will mark it. And how we mark it is very different. Some will go to the National Memorial in Ottawa. Others will go to local memorials. Some people will be in school. Others will be in front of their TV or radio. And it's a day, I think, that is a very personal day. It is a sacred day for many Canadians, even though it is, of course, secular. And I think it's a day that is both about individual remembrance, reflecting perhaps on a father or a grandfather or a grandmother who served or may be affected by war, but it's also part of collective remembrance. And I think that, too, adds to the power of Remembrance Day.
Thank you, Dr. Cook.
Thank you very much.
To opening our business, especially in a pandemic, in that kind of situation, is very challenging. First, people don't know me. People don't know my product. To build a new clientele, to build a trust for them, to show them that I care about it, I do love my food. That was the biggest challenge. And of course, in all lockdown, I had to face it regards my employee, girls, ladies, what they work for me. I didn't want to tell them, sorry, I'm close, I'm not having a job for you. No, they have a families, they have a kids to feed. So this is very important because we are family orientated. And we decided to open. We, of course, essential business. So been very tough, very, very tough, as we didn't see people on the road. Market was completely quiet, but we knew that we have to wait, and we knew that we're gonna be fine. In this time, we built online shop, Vedel Online, and we did Uber Eats, which one is picking up and is very, very popular. We have a really good feedback. So this is the song for my heart. And and we try to expand. I'm thinking about opening another location. So I want to make Vedel famous. I want to make the Vedel place to be for all the families with kids, try the traditional food, what their grandparents cooked in the countries when they're from, or even Canadian people. They're more than welcome to come and try our famous pierogies. I try to be passionate about my food, organic food, food made with love, with all homemade, organic. So you can find food from all over the Europe, Polish, German, Ukrainian, Romanian, French, Armenian, so all kind of different types of food. Homemade lunches, we focus on the homemade lunches, grandma style. I keep always saying, like in my Genia Babcia house, how she cooked, I wanted this love and this food over here because I believe that would bring all people around me. And all the organic cold cuts, lovely selection of sausages, cheeses, European cheeses, great selections of mustard, French cookies, all what you need from Europe you can find here at the Vedel Touch of Europe. If you think good way, that's it. You have to, I had the option to cry in the corner and say, oh, pandemic is coming. No, you need to stand up and fight for it and have your eyes open, think outside of the box and do it.
The world is changing.
So keep up with Rob.
The Rob Snow Show returns on Rogers TV and City News, 101.1 FM and 1310 AM.
Well, once more on Remembrance Day, it is so wonderful to welcome back Matt Luloff, who is a city councillor and a veteran of the war in Afghanistan. Good morning, councillor.
Good morning, Rob. It's so nice to be with you today.
Yeah, it's nice to hear from you as well. No city politics today, councillor. No city politics today.
Oh, I don't.
We have the rest of the year to do that. We have the rest of the year to do that. What are you doing today?
Oh, well, we got quite a busy schedule today. We've got a wonderful family, the Baudrys, here, who live just off of Varennes, that put up an incredible display every year. So I went and spent the beginning of the morning with Monsieur Baudry and later Reese at the monument that he's put up. And I'm here at the Orleans Legion 632, which is home to the largest local ceremony in the Ottawa area. Of course, only trumped by the national ceremony down at the National War Memorial. And we're dedicating a forest today to the Samur family here in Orleans, who had several members of their family serve in both the First and Second World War. So it's a busy day of remembrance and lots of local stuff here in the East End.
Yeah, I'm wondering, sometimes people use this kind of term CFB Orleans, but you're the councillor. Give us a sense of the military family of your ward.
It is beautiful and it is incredible. You know, we are the closest suburb this side of the Greenbelt to the downtown core. So so many people come and get posted here, whether it's at National Defense Headquarters or at Star Top or other military installations across the city. And they choose to call Orleans home because it's, traditionally affordable. Beautiful, lots of access to green space, places to run and jog and take your kids. And so we're very, very lucky to have such a critical mass of serving members and veterans in this community. And we'll see thousands of them come out along with community members to pay their respects down here at Orleans Legion 632 for the ceremony today. It's quite the show they put on. We're very, very proud of the work that our Legion does here.
Very nice. In much of your advocacy work, you talk about the transition from serving in the forces to civilian life, that transition period.
Yeah.
What are some of the challenges that people face when transitioning from life in the military to civilian life in Canada?
I mean, each transitioning soldier faces their own battle. And that's why a one-size-fits-all solution doesn't work. And this is why we've decided to try and implicate all three orders of government in the care of our veterans. And at our level, we're taking a leadership role in my office with the Ottawa Veterans Task Force, where we focus on things like housing, mental health and well-being, and second careers. When you're in the Canadian Armed Forces, you know what to wear and how to wear it and when to show up and what to eat and what you're up to. And many veterans feel completely lost when they transition out of the forces. It's an entirely different world without the same kind of structure that you have within the forces. And it's difficult sometimes to translate some of the skills that you picked up, leadership skills, and some of the more soft skills that that you gain as a soldier or a sailor or an air person. And it's difficult to translate that into a civilian job. So people have trouble with employment. They have trouble just adjusting to the regular pace of life, and finding work afterwards. Some get out with horrific physical and mental injuries.
Yeah.
And when you're a member of the Canadian Forces, you have access to the Canadian Forces healthcare system. And so you relinquish your OHIP card. So you get out of the military and oftentimes you're left without a general practitioner, without a family doctor. So these are the challenges that that we're working on with the provincial and the federal government.
Okay. So specifically with housing, housing affordability for anyone in Ottawa is pretty much in crisis right now. Someone seeking housing, how much of a challenge is it right now to house veterans?
That's an excellent question. I participated in the point in time count, which was delayed from last year to this year. And we went out on the streets, looking, specifically my group was looking for homeless veterans, although we did obviously do everything that we could for everyone else that we found as members of the team. But there's been a significant progress made on ensuring supportive housing for homeless veterans in the multi-faith housing initiative in Suzanne Lee's project down at the old Rockcliffe Air Base, which is providing over 40 affordable and supportive units for veterans that found themselves without a home. It's an incredible building, the Andy Kurzweil building, and you know, provides the mental health support and financial support and all of the different all of the different supports that are required for somebody who's found themselves in homelessness and are, you know, transitioning back into, you know, living living in a home. It's a wonderful project, and I'm looking for opportunities to ensure that people that may not feel comfortable in that sort of single living quarters environment, you know, perhaps women, female veterans who may have been victims of sexual trauma and or more women with children, we're looking to take that model of Veterans House and reimagine it to ensure that we're not leaving anyone behind.
Okay. I want to ask you,
sure,
as a veteran of the war in Afghanistan, how you feel this Remembrance Day, just given the current state of affairs in Afghanistan? Is it bittersweet? Yeah. Is it difficult?
This one is particularly difficult. You know, we used to spend most of our time as Canadian Forces veterans of the war in Afghanistan, you know, mourning the 158 that we lost while we were there. But now this has a bit of a different flavor to it. When the 20 years, the two decades of effort that we put into fostering peace and democracy in a country that has fallen to the very tyrannical forces that we were seeking to extinguish is a very bitter pill to swallow. And so this year, you know, not only do I mourn my brothers and sisters that I lost overseas, but the thousands of Afghans that risked life and limb to stand beside us shoulder to shoulder, our interpreters, our Afghan National Army compatriots, Afghan Civil Order Police, the base workers, these Afghans that stuck out their neck to be there to help us out, that were left behind when the U.S. Army and other armies and our own pulled out of that country. It is an absolute tragedy that these people were willing to put their lives on the line for us, and they are left. They're left there with a government that has fallen at the hands of these tyrants. It is very bitter, and leaves an awful taste in my mouth.
Councillor Luloff, I appreciate your honesty, and I thank you on behalf of all our listeners for your service to your country and your continued service to the city. Thank you.
Thanks, Rob. It's nice to chat with you.
Yeah. Councillor Matt Luloff. The Talkback Hour on Remembrance Day. Your memories, your thanks, most welcome here at 750-1310 right after the news on City News.
City News.
CIWW 1310 AM in Ottawa.
And CJET 101.1 FM in Smiths Falls and the Valley. Number one for local news in Ottawa and the Valley. This is City News. Now on 101.1 FM and 1310 AM.
It's Thursday, November 11th. Good morning. I'm Andrew Boyle. Right now in Ottawa, 2 degrees, in Smiths Falls, 3. Here's what's making news in Ottawa and the Valley. Most retail business closed until 12:30 this afternoon. Restaurants, pharmacies, corner stores, and gas stations are still open this morning. Most city and provincial and federal offices are closed for Remembrance Day, but garbage and recycling still being collected. Also, keep in mind all buses in Ottawa and Gatineau will be pulling over at 11 o'clock if it's safe to do so for 2 minutes of silence. There are road closures in effect around the National War Memorial at Elgin and Wellington for the ceremony that gets underway in under an hour. City News will bring you live coverage starting just before 11 o'clock. Now, after last year's ceremony was closed to the public, this year the Legion welcomes back those who want to honor the fallen at the National Memorial site. Here's City News reporter Chris Curries.
Safety first, according to Stephen Dieter, a spokesperson for many area Legions, who says even with capacity limits being increased, they're hoping people are safe for what is an important moment to reflect.
For me, that 2 minute silence at 11 a.m. on November the 11th really gives me a chance to think about all that could have been from all those lives that were lost.
Dieter served for 21 years and has taken part in the ceremony before, but this year he will be escorting Prime Minister Justin Trudeau when he lays the wreath on the tomb of the unknown soldier.
To be part of the physical event itself is almost surreal.
A reminder that road closures will be in effect this morning from 7 until 1 near the War Memorial. Chris Curries, City News.
City News time, 10:02. The Ontario government is helping build tiny houses for homeless veterans. The province says it's investing a couple of million dollars. Now, this is Kingston-based, and Housing Minister Steve Clark issued the special zoning order to allow for the site to be used for residential purposes without a long wait time. Ontario says an acre and a half of land will be transformed into a veterans village in Kingston, complete with as many as 25 tiny fabricated prefab homes. Each unit will have a kitchen, a bathroom, living room, and sleeping area. The homes are meant to be used as transitional housing for veterans who are experiencing homelessness. Now, your forecast with the Remembrance Day ceremony getting underway in under an hour. Here's City News meteorologist Jill Taylor.
Above average temperatures as we mark Remembrance Day, but with that gusty wind out of the east, it will feel cooler than the temperature indicates. The high today, 9 degrees. We get into the rain overnight, 5 for the low, and tomorrow we'll start with rain, some showers for the afternoon, and continuing windy, a high about 12 degrees. For today, the high, 9.
And right now in Ottawa, it's 2 degrees. It's 3 in Smiths Falls. City News time, 10:03. Firefighters remain on scene of a blaze at a home on Rideau Valley Drive. A 911 caller this morning, just shortly before 3 o'clock, reported flames on the outside of the home. Now, crews arrived, and 10 minutes later, they confirmed the house was engulfed, at least the roof of the attached garage, but it was quickly spreading to the rest of the home. No injuries reported, but an excavator had to be called in to help move some debris to find the hot spots. And the approximate amount of damage to that home, roughly $750,000. A fire investigator called in to determine the cause. Former South African President F.W. de Klerk, who shared the Nobel Peace Prize with Nelson Mandela and oversaw the end of his country's white minority rule, has died at the age of 85.
De Klerk will be most remembered for unbanning the African National Congress and releasing Nelson Mandela, a move that saw both men win the Nobel Peace Prize and the first democratic elections in South Africa. When Mandela was elected as president, de Klerk served as his deputy for 2 years. Despite their often acrimonious relationship, Mandela spoke of his respect for de Klerk at his 70th birthday party. Liesl Tom, ABC News, Pretoria, South Africa.
And I'm Andrew Boyle for News Anytime. Follow up online at ottawa.citynews.ca.
Talk back.
Hello.
On the Rob Bob Snow Show. The phone lines are open at 613-750-1310.
Now, the Rob Snow Show continues.
Who or what do you think about on Remembrance Day? Here is another Remembrance Day, Remembrance Day 2021. This is your hour. It has always been your hour for as long as I've been here doing this show. And the phone number to call is 750-1310. 750-1310, 613-750-1310 to express your thoughts and share your memories. Offer your thanks. It's a privilege to take your call today. We don't have the entire hour, but we do have plenty of time. We will join the broadcast of the National Remembrance Day ceremony. That starts at 10:45 this morning, so we have about 40 minutes or so together. So I turn the airwaves of City News over to you. What do you think about? Who do you think about on Remembrance Day? Here it's 10:06, and we have lots of lines available, and the wait won't be too long. Once again, 750-1310, 750-1310, 613-750-1310. I think about pictures in my grandmother's house, black and white pictures. My grandfather in uniform, and my grandmother young and pretty and beaming with pride. That's what I think about. One picture in particular sitting on the mantle of the dining room of my grandmother's house for as long as my grandparents lived in that house. Very much a Canadian post-war couple. Met before the war, married shortly after the war. And it was the same with my grandmother's sister. She married my grandfather's brother. Two Nicholson sisters from Dominion, two Snow brothers from the north side. And the eldest was Rod, and he was a heck of a ball player and a heck of a piano player, served in Europe during the war. And I recall a picture of him with his love. Often we were told in the Snow family about how his company stole a piano from the Germans so Rod could play the piano for his mates in Europe. He learned to play piano from his own mother. And she played the piano in the local movie theater. She was the soundtrack for the silent movies, you know. These are all very sanitized memories of war that I have. There were really no war stories to speak of in our house. No tales of bloody battles, just black and white pictures. And I think about my stepbrother, RMC grad, officer and engineer who served, like Councillor Luloff, in Afghanistan. Didn't need to. He was in a reserve unit by that time, but served anyway because he felt obligated that it was his duty. I don't think many of us would have it in us to do that, but he did. And it caused his mother, I know, many sleepless nights, a map of Afghanistan in my father's living room with place names memorized, place names like Kandahar and Kabul. He's probably right here, she would say, pointing it out on the map. I think about tribes along the shoreline of my hometown in Cape Breton Island. Where all along the shore road stand scattered old bunkers, dug out of the earth, lookouts on the watch for the threat of German U-boats hunting merchant mariners. I think of the SS Caribou, the Newfoundland and Nova Scotia ferry, sunk by a German sub, nicknamed the Laughing Cow, the day after Thanksgiving, October 1942, 137 passengers and crew lost. This is who and what I think about on this day. Remembrance Day. Who, what do you think about? 750-1310. 750-1310. 613-750-1310. A few calls and we have time for many more. And I'd love to take them. Brenda in Almont. Thank you for calling, Brenda.
Yes, I'd like to talk about my father.
By all means.
Hello?
Yes, go ahead, ma'am. You want to talk about your father, you said?
Yes, my father served in the Second World War in 1944. He was wounded and nearly severed his spine.
My God.
He came back to Montreal, and he spent a year and 11 months in Montreal. They put a steel disc in his back, so he did, because he couldn't walk very well. Anyway, I belong to the Legion in Almont, and I have supported them for many, many years, and today I will lay a wreath for my father.
Oh, very nice. Very nice.
Yeah, he was a Cobden boy, so he was. And he was a very good father.
He was. Okay.
Yeah.
What was his name?
Frank J. Edwards.
Frank J. Edwards. From Cobden.
Yes.
Yeah.
He was from Cobden.
And... how old was he when he went over? Do you know?
He was in his 40s when he went over.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yes, he was in his 40s when he went over. And when he came back, he kind of suffered from a bit of PTSD.
Sure.
He went out west to find jobs. It was hard to find jobs for veterans at that time. And he went out west to find work. And that's where he met my mother.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
He was much older than my mother, but
right.
He was a wonderful person.
Sounds like a tough guy.
He was.
Yeah, Brenda, I can hear you're kind of choking up there, just thinking about it, eh?
Yep.
Yeah. I thank you for sharing those memories.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah, Brenda, in Almont, with a memory of her father, and just like that, folks. 750-1310. It's Remembrance Day on the Rob Snow Show. It's our talk back hour. It's your hour, and I'd be pleased to take your call on Remembrance Day. Mark in Ottawa. Good morning, Mark. You're on City News.
Oh, good morning, Rob. I have two perspectives from growing up. I remember as a kid, I was born in 68, and I remember as a kid in the 70s being out in the public with my mom and dad and often seeing veterans or older men with limbs missing. And I remember asking about it all the time, and my parents would always try to quietly tell me that, you know, I was likely a veteran of the war, and they made a big sacrifice for the country. And at the time, it had a big impact on me. It gave me this respect for older people who have done a lot of great things for the country. And the second perspective was, I had an uncle that actually, my dad comes from Cape Breton. He's from Inverness.
Oh, really? Okay. Yeah.
And I had an uncle who, at the tender age of 20, went to the Korean War. And when he came back, he had no physical injuries, but, psychologically had a lot of problems. And it to a certain extent, it fractured the family, even to this day. And, some people don't take note of that what people bring back from these conflicts and these wars has a tremendous impact on generations. And
we know so much more about it now, and there are services available now, whatever shortcomings there may be in the mental health care system for our forces. There was nothing then.
Well, my mother used to, because I used to ask my mom why my Uncle Frank had these issues, and she just said he was shell-shocked from the war.
Shell-shocked, yeah.
Yeah, and what's interesting is your previous caller with the gentleman, Frank J. Edwards, that served from Cobden, my uncle also went out west, and I wonder if he was going out there to seek some kind of peace or to run away from his problems. He eventually did come back, but he didn't find what he was looking for,
Right.
So.
And that's who you're thinking about today.
Yeah, I feel sad that it takes a day like this to spend more time thinking about him. But it always, all these emotions and these memories flow back as we approach November 11th.
Yeah.
I actually find it hard. Like, I'm glad that we're extended. This is the first time in a long time I've had today off as a day off.
Right.
I work for an American company who extended it, and I used to find it difficult working on days like today because I did feel it was a bit of a sense of disrespect. So.
All right, Mark. I appreciate your call, sir.
Thank you.
Sharing your thoughts, very personal thoughts there. Thank you. All right, 10:15, a couple of lines there for you. It's 750-1310. It's our talk back hour. I've been another half hour to take some calls, share some memories. This is the Rob Snow Show on City News.
I'm blessed to be married to someone who is a scientist and spent a lot of time following what was happening over in China ahead of time. So he did give us the heads up that this was coming. Not that we believed him right off the bat, but when it did happen very, very quickly, we were prepared. We had hand sanitizer and we were set up to not close our doors. So we locked the kitchen down at Wellington Street, but we left this kitchen open. We put in protocols immediately. We only allowed our very small crew of four or five people in at the time. No deliveries were allowed to come in or out of the building without, they just weren't allowed in out of the building. So we met them at the loading dock and had very strict protocols in place right away. We had masks and hand sanitizer and the whole thing. So we're very lucky from that perspective. And we're able to, you know, learn as we went as far as doing small individually packed caterings, the frozen soup program, food for the Ottawa mission. So we didn't have to close the kitchen and then learn how to reopen it. We just were able to modify and shift as we needed to. Because of our partnership with the Ottawa mission, we were able to very quickly help support them. They were able to send us some product and some supplies, so it wasn't a burden on our business, and we were able to supply the staffing and the packaging to help produce that when they needed it the most. And we produced about 1,400 meals a week to complement their meals, and we started our soup program right away. We realized very quickly that there was a need in the community to get together and all work together, not only to support local, but also just to support all the people that were suddenly in a position of, you know, being locked down and not being able to get out. So by starting that soup program, our community, our clients got online and started making donations for the soups. And we were able to produce the soups and get them back out to people that needed it. We're right now currently making 150 liters of soup per week, but we've made, I would say, 5,000 or 6,000, you know, easily since the pandemic, probably more. I'd have to do the math, but lots. I think everybody in the city has to be very aware of how blessed we were to have great weather this summer, and people were able to get out and about, and that's going to shift. So we do have to be much more aware of who our most vulnerable is, and I really think we have to work together as groups. There are so many organizations in the city that are doing something and contributing and working together, and I think it doesn't matter who, but see what you can do to just step up and help them, whatever it is, whether it's driving or delivering food, or, you know, someone has extra zucchini in their garden, or if they can afford to donate some money to any of these organizations. I just think we all have to work together. We're smarter and wiser than we were the first time.
Time to talk back
on the Rob Snow Show.
Have your say and call now.
613-750-1310.
Who or what do you think about on Remembrance Day? Andy in Morewood. Good morning. You're on City News, Andy.
Good morning, Rob. I got two quick points to make. One,
sure,
I remember talking to my uncle who served in the Wavy Navy, something that took years and years and years before they were actually recognized as actually part of the military recognition.
You mean the Merchant Marine, sir? The Merchant Marine? Is that what you mean?
That's right. Yeah,
yes.
He was on the bobbing corks called corvettes.
Oh, okay.
On the escorts, and was sunk twice.
Wow.
And in those days, on the sea, they didn't stop and pick you up. It was the ships behind you would try and wander over to pick up, because trying to turn around to pick up it, but you already had one sunk or hit.
Sure,
was
sure.
Dangerous.
Yeah, oh, very dangerous.
So he got,
yeah.
But he, that's, yeah. He never talked about it as much as I tried over the years.
No.
He didn't talk about anything. It was a topic that wasn't discussed. However, when he died, a line in his will, my father was the executor, a line in his will said, make sure that the Legion knows he's gone. So that was one part.
Yeah.
The other part that I think, I don't know how many people would remember the thing, but I remember when I was going through boot camp in Chilliwack, we went on parade. It was freezing cold. And we were on parade, and you're sitting there going, you know, why do I do this? And then you looked at the old guys who didn't complain. They stood on parade. It was emotional. Then you'd go to the Legion afterwards,
mm-hmm.
and all these guys had was memories of good memories of the people that served. It's something I'll never forget.
So Wavy Navy, I am just learning about this now, thanks to David. Royal Navy Reserve, colloquially known as the Wavy Navy. Okay, very interesting. Voluntary service. Okay.
That's right.
Okay. Wavy Navy. So not the Merchant Marine. Wavy Navy. Navy Reserve. Okay, interesting. Yeah. I'd never heard that term before, Andy. Thank you so much.
You learn something new every day.
I do. I'm always open to learning something new every day, Andy. That's and you're getting a little choked up just thinking about it too, right? Yeah, it's an emotional day today, and I felt it coming in today. Seems even more emotional than years past. I think I hope it's because we're coming out of this, and we're kind of more appreciative maybe of sacrifices that have been made in the past on our behalf. I hope that's what
and
it
honestly,
is anyway.
I hope people support the Legion. What they do is without effort, without thinking about it, is help guys that need it.
Yeah. Well said, Andy. Thank you, Andy. Yes, thank you. Had you ever heard that term before? Wavy Navy?
Not till I just looked it up for you.
Thank you. Yeah. Darlene in Nepean. Good morning, Darlene.
Good morning, Rob.
Who are you thinking about today?
I was thinking of Rabbi Bolka.
Yeah, Rabbi Bolka, yes.
And his last Remembrance Day speech and the War Memorial. And I badly misquoted, but it was, be aware, listen and watch for what's going on around you and talk about it. And he was a very aware man. He was very proud to be Canadian.
Mm-hmm.
And it was more than that, but if something's out of place, then pay attention to it. Just don't brush it off. And I find that very pertinent to what's happening today in our country, the divisiveness. And, but, you know, on to nicer things is just when you look in the faces of war vets, and especially the older ones, you see a softness in their face and a wisdom. And it's, I don't know, it's very touching and very different to what we see in a lot of faces today. And it's a very special day.
Yes, it is, Darlene.
Yeah.
Yeah.
God bless everybody.
Yes, God bless you, Darlene. Yeah. Thank you. It's great to hear your voice today, Darlene. Thank you. Monica in Ottawa, you're on City News.
Hi.
Hi, Monica. Who are you thinking about, or what are you thinking about today?
I'm thinking about my father.
Okay. Tell me about your father.
He was in the RCAF.
Okay.
He was shot down over Germany. His parachute saved him, but the Germans captured him.
Wow.
And he spent the last 3 years of the war in a prisoner of war camp.
Wow.
And he came out weighing 120 pounds with no fingernails or toenails, and he met my mom recuperating in London, so she was a war bride.
Oh, really? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And how was he after that?
He was a lost soul. I mean, he stayed in the armed forces until the Diefenbaker years when they cut a lot of them. So he was, like, angry and bitter about that. And he was always kind of searching, chasing a dream after that.
Hmm.
I think it really took its toll on him.
It did.
Yeah. For sure.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Monica.
You're welcome.
Thank you for your call. Yep.
Okay. Bye.
Appreciate it. Beverly in Nepean. Good morning, Beverly.
Good morning.
Hi, Beverly.
I'm thinking about my dad, who was also in the Wavy Navy.
Oh, okay.
The way the Wavy Navy was explained to me was that it was people who joined the regular Navy, but only for the duration of the war. It was not Merchant Marine.
No.
Who joined just for the duration of the war.
Okay.
And it was a kind of a weird story. My mom met him when he was on the ladyboats going from Montreal to the islands, Jamaica and so on, bringing bananas back. And
okay, okay.
Things.
Yeah.
And she wouldn't marry him if he was at sea. So he quit. And they got married in 1939.
Okay.
The war started.
Right.
We didn't have much of a navy when Canada joined the war. They were building ships in Collingwood, and they needed experienced sailors to navigate them down the St. Lawrence to the ocean.
Right.
So guess what he did?
War right back out, right? Yeah.
And yeah. So this new bride lost her husband to much more dangerous waters than he had been in originally.
Yes.
And he served for the duration of the war. He was given a special rank, which some people wouldn't believe me about till they looked it up. Captains of ships were called skippers, you know, in Navy jargon.
Sure.
But they did create a rank for people like my dad, and there were only a few of them during the war who wouldn't accept normal commissions because they wanted, they were sort of reverse knobs, wanted to stay with the man and not be officers. And so he was created a skipper, and he did serve till the end of the war. He was a little tiny man, only about 5'4½, weighed no more than 120 pounds. And he too would not talk hardly at all about his experiences.
No.
Because he said you could never want to relive the horrors of seeing all the people you had to leave behind in the ocean burning, but they didn't dare stop the ships because the new boats would blow them up too.
Yeah. Terrible, terrible circumstances. Yeah. Yeah.
But he came back, he survived, he was one of the lucky ones, and took advantage of the Veterans Land Act and
okay.
was able to buy a house
oh, good.
Really, really cheap and live there and raise his family. And it was a wonderful, wonderful place to live with all the veterans sharing their same experiences
yes.
and helping
yeah.
each other. So it was a good outcome in the end.
It had a happy ending.
It did.
That's good, Beverly.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. I'm learning so much already in just this half hour on the radio. And it's because of people like you, Beverly. Thank you. And we'll talk soon. Okay, that's halftime. When we come back, we'll have about 15 minutes or so before we join the national ceremony here in Ottawa. So we'll...
This program is brought to you by Ignite TV. Now you're in command. Visit rogers.com for more details.
Call the Rogers TV viewer response line. Email us or connect with us on social media.
Wednesdays at 7:30 p.m., it's the RTV Quiz. Giovanni Petiti hosts a weekly trivia competition that lets you play from the comfort of your couch. Play along at home and challenge your friends. And don't forget to follow along on social media. Let us know who's top of trivia, and you can find yourself featured on a future episode.
Are you kidding me, folks?
The RTV Quiz, Wednesday nights at 7:30 p.m. on Rogers TV or at rogerstv.com/RTVQuiz.
October 5th, 2014, my daughter was hit by a train. She was walking along the sides of the tracks, and it shattered her world.
Color party, by the left, quick, march!
Thank you.
On the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, 103 years ago, an armistice was signed to end hostilities of the Great War, World War I. Since that time, November 11th has been a day to reflect on the sacrifices made by the few that continue to benefit so many. Good morning and welcome to the Royal Canadian Legion, Orleans Branch 462. Dan Mooney alongside Joe McNulty.